Welcome to the Parasite Podcast, a show about me and you. We are Venom.
Hey everybody, welcome back to another episode of the Parasite Podcast. And today I'm very excited because I have a gentleman on who I actually became friends with through YouTube by making a weird video, like asking him to come to the Justice League premiere with me. And ever since then, I've always wanted to do a show to have him on because he's kind enough to have me on his show a couple times. And that is Dave, the Film Junkie. Dave, thanks for being here. How are you? Say hi to people and let them know where they can find you on social media and your YouTube.
What's going on, Parasites? Yeah, I'm Dave the Film Junkie. You can find my videos on The Film Junkie, two E's at the end, you know, Junkie. I also have a second channel where I take I take clips from the live shows that I do and kind of put them in clip form, you know, more shorter stuff, just, you know, talking about a specific thing. That's just simply Film Junkie or Film Junkie Shots. And you can find me on Twitter at Davey Pena, two E's on Dave, P-E-N-A, and that's me. What's going on, Seek? How you doing?
I'm good, man. And everyone, those links that he just said, they will be in the description box below so that you're one click away from checking out his content, which is really awesome stuff. You're one of those few people on YouTube that kind of opened my eyes to something that I originally didn't agree with. And hearing you talk about it more and hearing the, you know, the people you've talked to and the guests you've had and over the years, and you've made me a more accepting person on something. and I honestly, it's a give you a lot of credit. You and my former boss at Top Cow, you both kind of opened my eyes to a lot of the Snyder stuff. And so we'll get into that in a little bit. But really what I want to start off with is kind of a little bit about you. And those of you who haven't heard a Parasite Podcast episode before, check them out. This is me. It's not just about Venom. We'll talk a little bit about that later. But it's me getting to know my guests and kind of showing you other fandoms and other people out there that make amazing things. And I think Dave is just one of my favorite YouTubers, definitely. And you, what kind of got you into... you know, like a little bit of background on you. Did you grow up liking superheroes? Did you grow up liking, you know, sports or commentary? Like what kind of was the basis or foundations of what you think might have led to the kind of content you make today?
Well, how this whole thing kind of started. Hey, can we actually start over? I didn't have my mic like actually set up. Would that be okay?
Yeah.
Led
to you making the current content you're making now?
Well, I think it's just my love of movies, you know? Anybody who wants to go see a movie, I'm down. I'm like, I don't even care what it is. I love the movie-going experience. And just being a kid and watching certain movies, your Back to the Futures, your Ghostbusters, anything back then, like in the late 80s, early 90s, that I really got into, and I'd always be like, hey, let's play Ghostbusters, let's live action Batman and whatever the hell, you know. It was always I always had like a fascination with the storytelling with everything. I mean, there was, you know, other movies, even like Never Ending Story, that me and my brother would get into. And it when it came to me leading to me like doing my channel, I would say that there was like a point where I was in high school, like beginning of high school, where me and my friends would make like little sketches and whatnot, and just have like, we had like this crappy little video camera, and we just come up with some stupid sketch and just kind of improv the whole thing. So I was always fascinated with just storytelling, being funny. And sometimes, you know, when it came to certain friends who were just like in the movies too, just having like an overall discussion and just talking about movies, like we'd go see a movie and then go to somebody's house and talk about it for like the next 2 hours over, you know, a bag of Fritos and some Pepsi or something like that. And I think that's just kind of, I've always just loved that just dynamic of talking about movies with people. And I think that kind of shaped where things with my channel is now. You know, when I do my vodka stream, it seems like every week now, there's just a panel of like friends that I've met online. You know, you've been on it, which has always been fun. You know, specifically like when Venom came around, you know, a lot of people love that episode where you broke it down with like talking about Venom. We had a really good discussion about that movie, as well as other things too. But I think just growing up, just with that, kind of just has shaped things now, I guess you could say.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I got to say, watching your channel, you do love movies. It's clear, because you'll see movies that, like, I see maybe in the theater five movies a year. I It's not that I don't like movies, and I certainly, like, my mom was telling me I grew up loving movies. I'd go every weekend. I worked at a Blockbuster, you know, I watched like 10 movies a week working at Blockbuster. So my mom was like, you definitely went through a time where you just loved movies. But post, you know, my health issues, I've definitely lost interest, because going to the theater is like an overwhelming health experience for me with other people around. So it's kind of dampened me from going, but I'll see your posts all the time. In fact, you do these things that I think are really fun, which I emulated recently that you did, and someone gave me crap for it, which was you do these great things where you do your initial reactions. And you just come out and you just make like a quick 30 second to 1 minute video of just basically your initial reaction of stuff. And you started that around the time of Justice League, and then you carried that on to today. So what kind of was the impetus for that? Like, what was like a thought of like, let's get something quick out there that people might like?
I think it's just because people have short attention spans, which could be the case. I don't know. I mean, it's funny because you're always constantly trying to conform to whatever, you know. A lot of people say, oh yeah, people have short attention spans, and you had apps like Vine that were like 6 second videos, but then that got wiped out, and now you can do longer videos. And now it seems like the game has changed since then, where it's now people are all about live streaming and long range videos. I mean, you really have to adapt to what people are craving, I guess you could say, what your audience actually wants. So when it came, and that doesn't mean like I'll just totally take that away, because I mean, obviously the way things are right now, I haven't been able to go to the movies in like the past two months or 2.5 months. But I think it was just because I thought it was just kind of when I do my film reviews, it's like, yeah, you think about it and you think about what you, the critiques that you had for the film, what you loved about it or liked about it, what you didn't like about it. There's all that breakdown. But sometimes people just, you know, when I go see the movie on Thursday night, sometimes I won't get the actual film review out till Saturday morning, sometimes Sunday morning, because it, you know, it takes a little bit more of a process. So I thought, well, why don't I get like an initial, like right as I get into my car after watching a movie, let me get my initial reaction, put that out there first, and then people can come back if they want to see like my full-on breakdown of the movie.
Yeah, no, I personally like it. I actually do have an attention span and like watching long videos, and I'll watch them all the way to the end. If they're 2 hours long, 4 hours long, if I'm engaged, I keep watching. But I do like those, that process of like, oh, let's just get an initial thought out there for those people who are like, they just want a sample. They just want to know basically what I thought about it. And I like it. It's good. And like I said, I kind of emulated that recently, but I did more of a comedic take where it was just 30 seconds of me sleeping. And I said a Venom comic just bored me to sleep, and then I put in there like full review coming, you know, in 2 days, and yeah, people were like, dude, what the heck, man, you can't even review the comic. I'm like, it's a joke, man, like it's a joke.
You gotta just let them know, like, hey, you know, just a little tease, you know, there's nothing wrong with just teasing like the full review. And yeah, I know sometimes like the audience will give you the feedback, and hopefully there's only just like a couple of people that are like, what the fuck, you know, like, and hopefully if you look at everything else, you look at other comments, they're like, oh, this is great, this is fantastic, and the likes are good, you know. What I always tell people when it comes to the way they handle your YouTube channel, I mean, there's just a lot of trial and error. I've been doing this for a while, and I still have trial and error. It's just things that don't work and things that do work, you know, and you're just always going to constantly have that. But I think, like, overall, when you have that base of an audience, that foundation, the people that are constantly like coming back to click on your videos, they're not going to mind. Like, those initial fans are going to want to see like your first reaction. Then, oh, cool, a little tease. Now I can't wait to see what he says full on. So it's just all trial and error.
Yeah, exactly. I think most people, like you said, most people know that, and they. You know, I gotta say, I've been very lucky. I haven't had more than a couple people come at me in a negative way. So, and that's okay. I don't mind it either. I don't mind people challenging me. It's just as long as they do it where it's like, it feels like real criticism. But the way we met, because it's funny, I've been watching your channel for a while, and when Man of Steel came out, you know, I was actually not a fan of the movie, and this is not me. We're not going to get into an argument. I know me and you've always been respectful to each other on these things.
Of course.
And But what, you know, I saw the movie and I dressed as Superman when I went to the movie, actually. And I was that's how excited I was. And I walked out a little disappointed, but I did see other people like it. I remember getting online, and at first I was one of those idiots who would just like, you know, I would see someone post how much they love it, and I just had to go in and go, well, this part didn't, this. And I was totally one of those douchebags. And luckily I wasn't one for very long. Because at that time I was working at Golden Apple Comics, and I went to work for Top Cow Productions. And Top Cow makes characters like Witchblade and Darkness and all these great comic characters. And my boss over there, Matt, he bought me lunch one day, and we were talking about marketing and comics and how we can get our comics to sell more. And he said, hey, did you see Man of Steel last weekend? And I said, yeah, I did. And he goes, what'd you think? And I told him, and I broke down what I did and didn't like about it. And he was very patient. He just sat there and listened to me. And then he goes, you mind if I tell you what I liked about it? I was like, sure. And he went on this like 10, 15 minute thing about how much he liked it. And then he ended by saying, you know, never in my life before. And Matt had worked in comics since like the early 90s. So he had been in comics for like, you know, almost 20 years. And he said, he goes, I never once liked Superman until I saw this movie.
Wow.
And that blew me away as someone who's been a fan of Superman since I was a kid, since Christopher Reeve. And so I was blown away by that. And I think him, and then soon after, I found your channel, not too long after, around the time of BVS, I think. And hearing your conversations and the point of view you have really did pull me back and make me less of a douchebag, and make me go, you know what's so cool about this is that these guys love a character that I love, and that made me realize, well, this is how Superman stays around and relevant for 80 years, is by constantly being reinterpreted. And yeah. And I owe that a lot to you. Like, you helped me grow in that way and be a less douchebaggy, toxic fan. So if I could pat you on the back for that, have you had anyone else that maybe used to be a little vitriolic towards the fandom that you've kind of, you know, opened up conversations with and had that response with?
Oh yeah, you know, even in real life, you know, I've had people that go like, oh, that was just like, you know, that final act was just crazy. It was just buildings falling everywhere. Can you believe this, that? And then, you know, you just have a conversation, you kind of break it down, and you kind of just, you know, I'm never, you know, film movies are always subjective. You know, if you don't like a certain movie, I'm not going to sit there and just try to be like, no, you're wrong, and shout you down. I don't believe in that. I try not to take that kind of angle to it. I don't think that's the right thing to do. I just like discussing it. I'm like, well, this is my point of view. And even if it's a movie that I don't like, that somebody else is like, I welcome different points of view. And there's been times where that's changed for me with different movies as well, you know. There's times where I could discuss something where somebody didn't like it and I liked it, and then I heard their points, and when I watched it again, I went, you know what? Yeah, they're right. I'm seeing it in a different angle, and I'm not even like thinking that this is not as good as I once thought it was. But yeah, there's been other times too where, you know, specifically with Man of Steel, because there was even when I first saw Man of Steel, like, I enjoyed it, but there was things I did not like about it. I mean, I was one of the biggest one of my biggest gripes was the Jonathan Kent scene at one point, and because I always thought, well, I thought the heart attack was better. You know, the heart attack aspect of Jonathan Kent was better because that's something Superman could never save him from.
Right.
But then what I really, after watching it many times, just having discussions with people, now when I see the Man of Steel Jonathan Kent scene with the tornado and that decision, I mean, I understand it now, and I actually pretty much, I love that angle of it and that different interpretation of it now. So, I mean, even me, I changed my look on certain things with Man of Steel.
Yeah, that's the thing about movies too, and our perspectives, is that over time we do see the world differently, and therefore we see art differently, right?
Absolutely.
And so
that's what's so great about film,
right?
And even anything, any kind of art, you know, you could at one point you might at first just be like, and even that, I mean, that's what's kind of going back to the whole first reaction review. I mean, sometimes when I do a first reaction, I mean, this is literally like, you know, 3 minutes after I just walked out of the movie, and my first reaction could be different from what I do like in my review, because I'll sit with it for a night or two. So I kind of like even that aspect to the whole, like, here's my first reaction, but now I kind of maybe have a different kind of thing when I really thought about it and just let the movie sit with me.
That's the thing is like, and I think that's some things people don't understand, because I see a lot of YouTubers be like, you know, like even Grace, Grace Randolph will post her reviews of movies 2 days before they come out in America, because, you know, and it might be a non-spoiler review, but she does it because she's like, well, I have fans in other countries who have seen it. And it's like, okay, but now there's this video that none of us can watch, you know, here in the U.S. Or someone will watch and go spread the leaks and stuff online and spoil everything. But anyway, so she has her way of doing things. Everyone has their way of doing things, but everyone likes to rush and get out there. That's what I like about your channel, is that you will put out that initial reaction of just being like, hey, there's no way I can spoil anything, because I'm here for 30 seconds telling you that I liked it.
Yeah.
And then you can sit with it, because that's what art is. You know, you don't get something. You can maybe look at something immediately and go, you know what, overall I do like this, or overall I don't like this, but the details of it and why, you're right, you need time to simmer and let it fester. One of the things, you know, of how we kind of got in touch, and that kind of is involved in the Snyder, you know, universe as well, which is, I was upset just because I knew at this point the guy had his fans. So when Snyder was stepping down from, you know, directing Justice League, I wasn't super happy about that. And I actually, when they announced Joss Whedon, it made me like the decision even less, because it felt like a very corporate thing of like, hey, the guy who made, you know, we got our guy to try to do our Avengers, but now he has to step down. So let's get the guy who actually made Avengers to do it. And that's also my thing with James Gunn with Suicide Squad. Well, we got David Ayer, and he's going to make kind of what we think is our Guardians of the Galaxy. But now let's just get the actual guy who made Guardians of the Galaxy. It just feels very lazy. And then it's like, okay, well, if you want that kind of product and you hire the person that makes that kind of product, then you're going to get the exact same thing as that product. And people don't want that. I think at this point people were, whether the masses enjoyed it or not, you know, people were latching on to what Zach wanted to do, especially after the Ultimate Edition of Batman vs. Superman came out. So what was your thought process as a fan? And I know you said this a million times on your show, but just out of curiosity, because this leads on to how we met, going into Justice League, like, were you nervous? Were you trying to still be hopeful? Like, what was kind of your mindset?
Yeah, it was exactly that. You know, for like 6 to 8 months before that, there was all these reports that were coming out talking about all the drama that was happening behind the scenes. And then when Snyder stepped down, I mean, that was like, you know, obviously for a family tragedy, that was, you know, we all felt for him. But when I was hearing all these reports and various sites were reporting that they brought in Whedon, which I was optimistic about. Like, I wasn't like a huge fan of it, but I was optimistic. I tried to remain optimistic. And then, you know, then you hear Danny Elfman was coming in, and I was like, well, maybe that could work. But then I started hearing some of the score, and I was like, wow, some of that sounds familiar. I mean, okay. I actually did a video kind of making a jab at that before Justice League came out, which was actually pretty funny. A lot of people got a kick out of it, but, when it came to all the rumors, I was trying my best to just like debunk it. You know, I was acting just like a fan, a full-on fan, and just kind of going, you know, there's no way that Warner Brothers would bring Joss Whedon into reshoot the whole movie. It's only going to be a little bit. It's going to be the stuff that Snyder wanted, and the whole like, oh, they're going to remove the mustache. It's going to be minimal and blah blah blah. And then when I finally saw the movie, I mean, that opening scene, my smile went to a frown, and I went, oh shit. These guys were right. And it actually changed me. Like, that whole thing actually changed me in the way that I started doing videos for my channel, because I started realizing, I'm like, I can't fully just be a fan all the time. I mean, of course I can. I mean, I'm always going to be a fan at my base, but I also, when it comes to information that is out there or information I receive, I really got to like sit with it and vet it and kind of go like, okay, I'm going to give my opinion, but I gotta like not just full on just be like, oh, these guys are full of shit. No, that's not. I gotta actually take in and talk to people and have discussions, and you know, not, don't just do it like I do with like when I walk out of a film and do like a first reaction. I gotta kind of sit with it instead and maybe write something out and really get my thoughts about it out there.
Yeah, and that's something I've observed watching your channel is this. Is that shift of where it's like, okay, I want to have more of a conversation and take that element out. And that was around the time I started doing it, because when I first started the Venom vlog, I was very fanboy-y on some levels. Like I try to follow, there's a guy I watch on YouTube called Raging Nation, and he followed the Michael Bay Transformer movies. And what I liked about his channel is he would only talk about news that came from an official source, like Variety or you know, something like that. Like he didn't do smaller websites and he didn't do rumors or leaks. And so that I kind of took and I was like, all right, let's try to do that. But I would still have these insane fanboy moments. And it was around that time with Just League, I saw the shift in you that I started to mirror that. And I said, you know what? It is fun to be a fan and let that, you know, drive the boat for a while, but at some point, you know, it's got, you got to, you know, take a break and let someone else, you know, let the analytical side drive or let the critical side drive, you know, you got to shift it up. And that's what I really like about your stuff. And so leading up to Justice League, I saw on your show, like just you being this uber passionate fan of Snyder's stuff and you were really wanting to see Justice League. And I saw that you were trying to be hopeful and you were trying to like, you'd be this guy in the middle who was like between two extremes going, all right, everyone just calm down. Let's wait and see what the movie is. And I really appreciated you taking that attempt. And because I know how unthankful that can be among fans and how much backlash and tongue lash you can get. But seeing you do that, I won those tickets from Golden Apple Comics. So big shout out to them. I won tickets to go see Justice League at the red carpet premiere. And the only person I could think of was to take an absolute stranger who I had never met in my life. So I'm kind of curious, what was that like to have people write you and go, dude, some weirdo Venom guy is like making videos asking you to go on a date with him. And it's like, no, I wasn't asking him on a date. It's like, it wasn't that kind of thing. I'm just, he's a fan. And I didn't want to go to something that, I'm a big DC fan for sure, but I was nervous about the movie and I didn't want to go with somebody who wasn't a hardcore fan. It was my point of view.
Now, my first reaction was block. Just kidding. Yeah, I didn't think that at all. People, I remember waking up and people were sending me your video. And when I watched it, you know, I was just like, wow, this is very flattering because I mean, it's pretty crazy. Like when I, you know, the whole journey of doing this YouTube thing and the surrealness when people actually reach out like that. I mean, and you reached out in a way that you did it on, you know, your own channel and asking if I wanted to join you with all that. And I was like, well, as long as he buys me dinner first. And when you did that, I mean, I immediately contacted you and I thought, you know, great, because I watched the whole video and, you know, I was like, wow, this guy seems like he's cool. He's a nice guy. And I watched other videos that you had too. And I was like, yeah, that's, you know, that this guy seems like a really nice guy. It's like well-spoken and somebody I can actually talk to. So, you know, I accepted the offer, but I was like, you know, at the same time, I already had my appointment or ticket to go see Justice League on the Warner Brothers lot. So I didn't get to join you in the, you know, in the premiere, but at the same time, it was a very interesting experience because I remember walking out from Warner Brothers studio and just feeling like I got punched in the gut because, you know, that wasn't the movie, that was not Snyder's movie, but I'm going, okay, you know, speaking of first reactions, what do I tell people? There's so many people that are waiting for my first reaction. What do I do? Do I just completely just go, guys, I don't know what the hell, you know, or do I just kind of remain optimistic a little bit because I didn't want people to like really, you know, bring their hype levels down. So I kind of just, you know, I did as much as I could with my first reaction. I remember sitting in my car for like 10 minutes on the Warner Brothers parking lot going, what do I say? It was pretty difficult. And then I went over there and the whole thing was happening and I spotted you in the stands because you were wearing like Green Lantern stuff. You had your lantern and everything, I remember. Yep. Right? Yeah.
Yep.
So I remember spotting you and I think you spotted me and we kind of went like, hey. But of course, it was already too late. You were already inside. And, you know, which I, you know, it was just a bad timing. Of course, like I already had like my appointment for Warner Brothers Studio, or else I would have 100% just been sitting right next to you. But it was just kind of funny and a little interesting. Like when all the actors started coming through, and specifically when I saw Cavill, and I went, "Does this guy know? Does he know that the opening scene, his face just does not look right at all? Doesn't have that pretty Cavill face that we all have grown to love? No, I don't. Does he know this?" That's what I was like just thinking the whole time. And then one of the other things that I thought of was like, wow, Zack Snyder is not here.
Right.
His wife's here. Deborah was there. She showed up, but he wasn't there. And it was just like, you know, that's where I really kind of went, man, something really just happened with this movie that, you know, that's going to be something that people are going to be talking about. And here we are two and a half years later.
Yeah, I mean, that's the craziest thing. So, and you and I both, you know, we have people that, you know, have, you know, work inside Warner Brothers or work around Warner Brothers and have a little bit of a know. And we've heard, you and I both over the years, different things. Like, you know, I've had a friend tell me, dude, it doesn't exist. And this is someone who worked at Warner Brothers. Then I've had someone else at Warner Brothers tell me, well, there is a cut and we've all seen it, or some of us have seen it, but it's, you know, it still needs a little bit of work and stuff. And so it's like, okay, so there is a cut. So it's like, it was weird. Like, there was all these people. And the funny thing was, is there was like people like Collider and like all these other sites. And this is when I really noticed the divide between shows like that and like fans of this stuff. And what was crazy was that these guys were very aggressive and putting people down and saying, like, you know, oh, you think if you want this cut, you're living in a dream world. Obviously Snyder said something similar about something else, but it's weird how crazy these guys got on the fans of this movement. And me, like, I tried to just sit back and just be kind of impartial, because I'm like, well, I don't have a horse in this race. I love Snyder, I love his other movies, but I wasn't a particular fan of what he did with these movies so far. But I would be lying to say that I wasn't at least curious to see what he would have done. So how was it like now, 2.5 years, like you said, since Justice League came out, but 3 years in a way since people have been fighting for the Snyder cut, seeing all these amazing things like money raised for charity, billboards at Comic-Cons in New York and San Diego. Like, I have never in my life seen a movement like that ever. Never, man. And I've been a part of some very passionate movements to get like Young Justice back on TV, or, you know, other shows, Spectacular Spider-Man. I've done some my part in some of those things, but never in my life have I seen so much good. Now, granted, I feel like there's a couple people that took it too far, and, you know, of course that happens in every fandom, so that doesn't hurt me, the Snyder Cut movement, but other, you know, journalists and stuff think it does. But what's it feel like now? I mean, it's got to feel so amazing to have been pulling for this in a world where we've never gotten anything like this before. I know people mentioned the Richard Donner cut of Superman 2, but that was like decades later, and it isn't even really the full version of what he would have done. You actually got Zach back. You're going to get a potentially new stuff added. You're going to get the old stuff fixed up, and you're getting an HBO Max miniseries, essentially. Like, God, how does that feel, man?
Dude, I mean, it's surreal. I mean, when May 20th, when he scheduled that Man of Steel watch, it was kind of like, you know, I started reaching out. I reached out to sources, and I mean, my main source to him emailed me back and said, oh yeah, I just talked to him. He said Wednesday's it. And I went, holy shit. And then I just to read that, and I went, you just kind of sit back and go, wow, we're finally gonna get this damn thing, thank God. You know, I mean, it was almost like, you know, a monkey off her back, you know, a little relief, a little weight lifted off the shoulders. Because, you know, when I do my videos about anything that has to do with that, I mean, it would get to the point sometimes where I was like, okay, unless there's actual something that I have, I'm not going to do any Snyder Cut videos, because I want to, like, also talk about other movies. There's other movies out there. But, of course, everybody, when they're asking about, oh, you know, what have you heard about the Snyder Cut? And, you know, it sucks when nothing. I mean, nothing's happening. The last I heard, maybe, like, negotiations were happening. I don't know. But, I mean, when it came to back in November of last year, November 17th, I mean, there was a huge, huge push on social media, specifically Twitter, to tweet out the hashtag. And then Snyder was, you know, he was the one that was kind of running that. He tapped into some fans to do it, and then he got Gal Gadot to do it. He got Ben Affleck to do it. After that happened, we all kind of, like, some of, you know, people that I talked to, we kind of all went, wow. I mean, he coordinated that big time. So to us, we're like, he is definitely having negotiations, and he probably said in one of these negotiations, like, watch, we're gonna do something. We're gonna do a campaign on November 17th, and you're gonna see how many people are wanting this movie. And like you said, with all the positive stuff that came before that, all, you know, I had a couple of streams where any donations and whatever the video made ad revenue wise in a month, I donated that and then added some. I either doubled it or just made it to where it was a nice round number. you know, we did all that. And that's one of the things that gets almost ignored, like you said, when some of these bloggers talk about the Snyder Cut movement and the fandom, though, when they talk about this toxic side, and even they do that now, yeah, after it was announced. I mean, the Collider and some other people were saying it's a dangerous precedent, and they talk about certain things, and it was just kind of like, you never talk about all the good. Yes, they're always, every fandom's going to have those pieces of shit out there that just act like idiots, and they are toxic, but you also got to shine a light on all of the good and all the money that's been raised about suicide awareness. And it's just been great. And Snyder, I mean, we've seen him react to it where it's just, it touches his heart because of what happened within his family, the tragedy that happened in his family. So just to have it actually announced, it was just such a relief. I mean, that week was just insane. You know, I was doing my live stuff. People were just clicking in. And then when it came to the vodka stream that Friday, I mean, I literally got a bottle of champagne and popped it and went through the entire bottle with a 3-hour stream, which was just a lot of fun. I mean, it was just very surreal. And it was just, we were kind of all just on cloud nine, like, wow, this, we actually got it. We're here. We're going to see it. And it's just been pretty fantastic.
Yeah, I mean, I got to say, and a lot of your reactions, like you and Chris Ping Pong Flicks, I think his name is.
Yeah.
And Film Gob. Film Gob's funny because he's kind of like the Joker of your group.
He definitely is.
Yeah, he's pretty awesome. He takes it a little too far for someone like me sometimes, but I still enjoy his content. But he was one of those guys that I kind of railed against at first, but then, you know, he opened my eyes to some things, and so did Chris Wong. And these guys, I really like, you know, especially you and Chris is a kind of reaction to these haters, like Gob has been doing his thing where he calls them out, which has been fun to watch and entertaining. But you guys have been like, hey, I don't care if you're new to the fandom or have been here for months or been here the whole time, but welcome to the Snyder Cut fandom. And that approach is so awesome and classy in my mind. And just how you should handle situations like that. But yeah, those haters, like, it's like they couldn't even let you guys have a day to celebrate this 3-year-long marathon that you were on before they started like saying horrible things. And no, this does not set a bad precedent, actually. And neither did telling Paramount or whoever that Sonic the Hedgehog looked like a monster. Like, you know, it's so funny that they would say stuff like that, but yet they know exactly that every movie in the world that gets made has a test screening audience with average people, not fans, but average people. And they take that feedback and they'll do a couple reshoots or ADR lines, and they change almost every movie based on what average people react to. And so to sit there and say, oh, well, we can't let fans change things, it's like, why not? We let average people change things all the time. Uh-huh. So it's so hypocritical of them. So, you know, it's funny about the Justice League movie where when you didn't show up, or you weren't able to because you were at the Warner Brothers lot, which but when I went, you know, I got to see you, which is great. Henry Cavill, yeah, I mean, when that first scene happened and I'm in the room with the guy, I did, yeah, like my heart stopped for him. And granted, and people can go back, they'll see my review and they're like, oh, you seem pretty positive about it. I'm like, well, my initial reaction to that movie was I had fun watching it in the way that I now have fun watching Batman and Robin, where like Batman and Robin is such a train wreck, but I much rather watch that over Batman Forever, because Batman and Robin's so far gone in the stupid, you know? And so I kind of had fun on Justice League in that regard. And there was a couple scenes in Justice League I liked, but I feel like those are probably things Snyder shot. But then on the reverse of that, though, I made a friend there named Andrew. When I didn't have you there, I just randomly talked to a person in line, and it was a guy named Andrew. He ended up becoming a good friend of mine. Me and him went to the Spider-Verse premiere together, and then he actually is the one who invited me to the Venom premiere where Tom Hardy was, where I got to meet him the first time. And so it's funny how things work out. But to tie this in, so your fandom I liked a lot, and what made me identify with them more and more as time went on, the Snyder Cut fandom, is there was a time where, being a Venom fan, I was getting crap thrown at me from MCU fans saying, they're like, your movie's never going to be in our universe. It doesn't count. It's, you know, it's so, and it's so funny because here we are now where, you know, now it's kind of in the universe, and Morbius and Spider-Man and Venom, and everyone's going to tie in together. And I'm just laughing. I'm like, oh, so this is what that feels like. Were you a fan of Venom at all? Like, did you see the movie? Did you like it? Are you, like, what were your thoughts on
that? I did.
Yeah.
I did, like, but I had, like, different kind of feelings for it. I mean, to me, it felt like there was too much studio, maybe some studio influence. And to me, some of the little, you know, things that played out in the movie, I felt, were they trying to be, like, a little too goofy right here? I mean, you got a Venom Pomeranian going on right here. What's going on? You know, just certain things. And specifically because, you know, I mean, I was excited for the movie, and you know, Tom Hardy is one of my favorite actors working today. I mean, anything that Tom Hardy does, I'm gonna watch. You know, So when he was cast, I was like, cool. Excuse me, sorry. When he got cast, I was like, oh, this is fantastic, this is great. And then when images came out and set videos, I mean, I covered those as well. But then, like, one of the things that you kind of notice is, like, well, okay, so I remember the set video when he was doing, like, his crazy Venom dancing thing and struggling. This wasn't in the movie. You know, I started kind of thinking stuff like that. So, I mean, overall, it's an enjoyable movie. But I just kind of think that they kind of hacked it a little bit too much, because my favorite parts of Venom were when Tom Hardy was communicating with the symbiote in his head. And the back and forth, and the crazy, the Venom, you know, struggling with it all. I think those were the best parts, and the fact that I know like that some of that was cut out, and I think even Hardy even came out like in an interview saying that a lot of that was cut out. That's what was kind of disappointing when it came to all of that. So that's why when it comes to Venom 2, I'm really hoping, since the first Venom, even though with all that cutting up and stuff, that it was still a success. I'm hoping with Venom 2 with Andy Serkis that things are going to be like, we're going to get like the actual full-on vision, and we're going to get more of the dynamic between Eddie and the symbiote. And, you know, of course, it's not going to be as crazy as it was in the first one, but I'm just really hoping that they just let them make their movie, because I know Tom Hardy is huge on bringing this character to the screen. Like, he's not just sitting there going, what's my lines? He's like involved with like the creative process of it all.
Yeah, I can speak for that. Seeing him on set in San Francisco, he is very much a guy who comes up with ideas, who mentions them to his DP and to his director.
I love it when actors do that. They're not just, like I said, they're not just going, what's my line?
Right.
And just reading off the lines. They're involved. That just shows they're passionate about it.
Well, it's good to hear you say that. I mean, yeah, I'm excited. Andy Serkis, and he obviously is going to play Alfred in the Batman coming up. And I know that you've been following that news too. So anyone out there who's a big Batman fan and Snyder Cut fan, if you want to follow Dave, please do. Again, links are down below so you can see the kind of the content he's making and everything, you know, everything regarding to those movies and other stuff too. Like you said, when movie theaters or when movies start coming back on a frequent level, you're going to get back to doing that too. So yeah, if you're a fan of movies, follow Dave. And, I guess the last thing, I mean, like me for the Snyder Cut stuff, like I always reference myself as a member of the team of the Outsiders, which is my favorite DC team. And I would say everyone who's in the Snyder Cut movement is the Justice League. So it's like our goals are the same to an extent, but I certainly can't take credit and would never try to of the work, the hard work that you guys put in. And like I said, I've never, ever, I'm almost 40 years old. I've never seen a fandom go to the level that you guys have and put out as much good in the world as you guys have, while also just, you know, wanting something that I felt was fairly simple for a studio to give. And it's so great that now AT&T and HBO Max are involved, because now they can give you guys something that I feel rightfully earned. I mean, other people may disagree with me on that, but I call those people stupid assholes. And I would say that you guys fought a battle for something that, and you got called crazy for it, and you got called all these names, and you still get called names. But because you endure that, you're like the frickin' X-Men to me, and you're like the Justice League, and you guys earned your movie. So I'm excited to hear what you think of that. I can't wait till it comes out. And I can't wait for more Cyborg, because he's one of my favorite characters. And him in the movie, I thought Ray Fisher was really great, and I wanted to see more of his story. And I've been hearing more and more that we're going to get a lot more Cyborg.
Well, he's like the heart of the story. I mean, even like today, like Ray Fisher tweeted out like one of the pictures that Snyder has posted before. That shows him, I guess, in kind of like a dream sequence where he's looking at his family that is no longer with him. And, you know, he just praised Terrio and Snyder for making him like the center. I mean, that's the thing. That's what people don't seem to realize, is like Cyborg is very much the center and the heart of Zack Snyder's Justice League, and that's what we're going to see. That's what we didn't see in the theatrical cut. A lot of his entire origin was almost completely removed from the theatrical release. So, like you said, if you're a big Cyborg fan, anybody who's a big Cyborg fan is going to want to watch Zack Snyder's Justice League, because he is the center and the heart of the overall story, and that's what everybody is like anxious to see. And I really hope that this really shows that, hey, Cyborg can be a very interesting character. I hope to lead to other things that he's going to be involved with, which I'm hearing little things that, yeah, that he might come back for certain things, maybe the Flash movie, I don't know, and, you know, maybe his own thing. And Ray Fisher really deserves it, because I think he's a talent that probably got screwed the most when it came to this whole thing, because everybody else was pretty established, or they had other franchises they were a part of. So I'm happy for the Snyders and everybody involved, I'm happy for Ray Fisher, because, you know, you could tell that he is passionate about this character and wants to show people the true character that he portrayed in this movie. And I hope that he can he'll definitely achieve that, and then some.
I can't wait. Hashtag Borg life.
Fuck yeah.
Well, Dave, man, I can't thank you enough. Is there any last words you'd like to say before we head out today?
No, man. It's like I said, it's just pretty great, like, how things happen, you know, how we became friends. I mean, before you moved to Florida, we met up for one last time. We had a nice little lunch before this whole COVID thing really wiped out restaurants and everything.
Right.
And, you know, it was just nice to actually full on meet you and just have a conversation. I mean, that's to see that video that you put out there inviting me, and me going, wow, this guy seems like he's cool, you don't seem crazy. You know, but so, you know, to do that and then just to build up on that friendship and have discussions with you, and then of course finally meeting you in person, I mean, it just shows you like what you know, having these platforms and having this technology that we utilize, these tools to connect with people. I mean, that's the positive side. I mean, there's so much negativity that can go with all this and being connected to everything, but we always got to shine the light on the good stuff, the good things that happen with all this connectivity. And it's just building relationships and friendships, and I think it's just absolutely fantastic, and looking forward to just it keep on going. And I mean, who knows, we'll just all be in virtual reality one day, living in the Matrix or something, and we'll all be able to leap building the building and stuff, and that'll be fun too.
That'll be awesome. Well, hopefully we'll still sit for 3 hours in a restaurant and talk.
Exactly.
Yeah, and I do want to say one last thing for you is that I owe Dave a lot, because there were times where my channel was like, it was monetized and it was demonetized, and I didn't have enough subscribers, and I started gaining some, and honestly I was struggling with that, because obviously what people don't realize is, on top of work where I was struggling at the time, and on top of health, which I was struggling, I really was hoping YouTube would be the thing that I wasn't struggling at. And then when that started to crumble for a minute there, it wasn't as bad as, you know, it turned out to be. Obviously, it wasn't nearly as bad. But Dave was one of those people that was like, dude, it's cool, man. Keep going. Keep doing your thing. Don't worry. Things are going to work out. You make great content, and you're going to pull people in. And holy shit, you weren't lying, because pretty soon after that, my channel took a big spike in views, and I owe a lot of that to you for telling me not to give up. And I would like to pass that message on to anyone out there who's making content. When things get rough, find a good friend like Dave and talk to them, and don't give up, and keep making the stuff that makes you happy.
100%. I mean, when people ask me, like, what do I do? How do I start a YouTube channel? I mean, first thing I say is, just turn on the camera and go.
Right.
You know, because your first video, you're like, you know, a couple of years from now, you're going to cringe when you watch that first video. I mean, it's just the way it is. And like we were saying before at the beginning of this podcast, it was just, you know, trial and error. It's always going to be I'm still going through that. I mean, I just started doing this live thing, you know, last month, and it turned out to be something that was a great decision. And you're just always going to have that trial and error. Things aren't going to work. Things are. And then, you know, when I saw you struggling with it, I was just like, no, you just got to keep on going and find that audience. Find that audience. And you found your audience. And when I saw that you were, you know, increasing, when you would tweet out or put on Instagram that your subscribers have gone up, your audience has gone up, I mean, it just it made me happy, because I'm like, yes, good people need to be recognized. Come on.
Well, I appreciate it. And I appreciate you, man. And thanks for still being my friend after all these years. And I'm glad. And I look forward to many more crossover streams that we'll have in the future.
For sure.
All right, everyone, and make sure you go check out Dave. Links are down below. Follow him on Instagram. Follow him on Twitter. Check out his YouTube channels. Make sure you subscribe to them both. I'm sure a lot of you guys have already, but for those who haven't, check him out. Really awesome guy, and follow all the movie news that he follows. He's really great. He pretty much covers everything else that I don't cover, and he still covers Venom stuff. So the guy is like really talented. So make sure you show him some love, and thank you guys for supporting this show. Leave your comments down below so you can be heard. We'll continue our conversation down there. Like, share, subscribe, all that fun stuff, and we'll see you in the future. Peace.